Okay, let's do this. My name is David Parsons, and you are listening to The Nostalgia Trap. I hope your week is going well. If you've listened to our show at all, you know that we're kind of obsessed with the end of the world here. That's been something that's been a through line to all our Nostalgia Trap episodes, is what the fuck are we going to witness in our lifetimes? I know it's an election year and we're kind of caught up thinking about Bernie and things like that, but the bigger picture is really important. And as I've gotten older and we've learned more about like climate change and financial collapse and things like that, it seems like we're going to see crazy shit in our life. I don't know what that means, and I certainly don't want to be a doomsday type of person, but at the same time, I think it's vital that we have a sense of urgency and a sense of perspective when we think about what's going on and what to do about it and how to set a tone as we move forward through this uncertain future. My guest today is someone who thinks a lot about the future. His name is Kevin Baker. He's currently a postdoc at Berkeley AI. That's artificial intelligence. He thinks a lot about computers, and particularly the way that policymakers and politicians have used predictive computer models to think about what might happen and why that's both a good thing and maybe a problematic thing. In particular, he tells us about this 1972 study called The Limits to Growth, based on some computer models that said that industrial civilization would collapse by 2050. That certainly seems more and more a possibility, if not a probability, in our life. So I wanted to talk about all of this with Kevin. He's a really cool and interesting follow on Twitter if you want to go follow him, at Kevin Baker. And he tells his story also of stuff that's very familiar to Nostalgia Trap listeners as well, which is kind of the intersection of class and academia. You know, he had to navigate and understand how class functioned at different types of schools in the same way that we've talked to many guests about. And even in my own experience, you know, I'm someone that didn't really get that academia had a very particular, there are a lot of rich people in academia, and I didn't really get that. And I didn't get how much class would determine my experience in the university. So we have a really fun conversation. I hope you enjoy it. We've got lots more going on our Patreon lately. If you ever wanted to subscribe to our show, now's a good time. We're starting to put a lot more stuff up. Later this week, we're putting some episodes up from Justin Rogers Cooper, in which he's talking about financial collapse and what's going on with the stock market. And we have a lot more stuff coming up on the Patreon talking about the election and how that fits into this wider picture. So if you're interested in that, go to patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. I appreciate all the people who are subscribing already, and we're going to start putting much more of content that's really conversations that I want only for subscribers. So if you want to be part of that club, go to patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. Okay, so I hope you enjoy this conversation. Here is me with Kevin Baker. All right, Kevin Baker, thank you so much for joining us. We don't get to talk to too many historians of science here, and I feel like it's a really important part of the historical discipline to talk about, because even on this show, we've partaken in the kind of stereotypical, opposing camps of STEM and the humanities that historians, I think, sometimes can fall into. But history of science is a place that kind of occupies, I feel like, a liminal space, to use an academic word. but thanks so much for joining. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thanks for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
When you think about history of science, I know very little about you. I know you're at Berkeley currently doing a postdoc. Is that right?
Yeah, I'm at Berkeley. I'm a historian by training, but right now I'm, embedded in a machine learning, group at Berkeley AI. So I'm straddling a couple of different fields right now.
What does embedded in machine learning mean?
So basically it's a relatively new position, so we're still kind of figuring out what it means, but I'm basically the in-house humanist and tech critic for a big machine learning group studying social applications of machine learning. So they wanted to cover their bases, I think. So they have a real life humanist.
Well, I mean, that's part of what I guess I'm talking about, right? Is like, how do you infuse like the sciences and tech with the human, with the kind of like humanity stuff? And it seems like, I don't know. Do you feel that tension? Is there a tension at all? Am I wrong to say that?
No, you're not wrong. I mean, like a lot of us in the history of science and the history of technology kind of feel like we have half a foot in like two worlds, but not like a full foot in any world, I guess.
Right.
So you're right to notice the tension. I think what I normally tell people that we do is what I do at least is I just study experts in the way expertise is used in society and used to further, you know, different social goals. Mm-hmm. Sometimes these are good, but often, you know, they're quite bad. We've had a great couple of weeks in the tech and app economy lately that I'm sure you remember from Iowa. So,
oh no, what are you talking about? Yeah, totally. I mean, it feels like actually the tech people are there's a lot of concern that the tech kind of introduction of tech into the electoral system makes it easier to manipulate and makes it people trust it less, which is kind of interesting when you consider like how much computers and tech are a part of our economy and society and how much we rely on them and trust them, etc. But when you talk about Iowa, you begin to kind of see a different kind of narrative, right?
Yeah, and I think the kind of the Iowa story kind of gets at a lot of the big issues that we care about in the history of science and the history of technology. For a long time, you know, there's one of the key books in my field is a book called Trust in Numbers by Ted Porter, and he kind of charts the rise of a kind of quantitatively oriented like public discourse. Like we might not be able to trust one another, but we can trust these kind of objective, impartial numbers. And he kind of sees this as a consequence of, you know, a rapidly growing, democratizing society that where people and even elites don't necessarily know one another anymore and don't have these kind of direct bonds of trust. But what we've seen in the past 30 or 40 years is the slow decay of the trust in this kind of this kind of quantitative expertise. And in the case of Iowa, you see with the Shadow app, you see humans being effectively cut out of the circuit of politics. So this is, you know, this is as much about removing humans from the story and, you know, removing labor from the story as it is kind of a tech story.
Yeah, it's like if we're becoming a bunch of fucking robots, man. And like that when I think about data and like hearing you talk, I'm like, oh, this is something I often present when I present the narrative of the Vietnam War to my students, because Robert McNamara, famously as Secretary of Defense, kind of, you know, relied on data and numbers and statistical analysis that he learned in the Ivy League to kind of to wage war in Vietnam, and that ended up kind of creating a human tragedy, the scale of which, you know, may have been accelerated actually by the statistical analysis, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, that makes perfect sense. I mean, like the big kind of computer and like technically oriented program of this like Igloo White, like this broad surveillance apparatus of Vietnam during the war, like where they had like sensors all over the Ho Chi Minh Trail and all of this stuff, it kind of points directly to today. Like what we see in Vietnam is basically prefigurative of our entire economy now. And the sort of resistance to that, I think we see, you know, prefigured too. One of the ways that the Department of Defense tried to monitor Northern Vietnamese movements was like placing urine sensors, like sensors that could smell urine,
right,
on the Ho Chi Minh Trail. And very quickly, the Northern Vietnamese figured out what was going on and just started pissing on the sensors. And, you know, this led to like the Department of Defense rapidly or like majorly overestimating the amount of people on the trail. So there's always been ways to kind of scam and game these systems.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like,
it's like the National Liberation Front and the North Vietnamese are like, you know, hacking the system in some way. It's such a fascinating thing. And like, I don't know. Okay, so we can get into like what you study and everything like that. But it makes me think of, in terms of the Vietnam War, you mentioned like the resistance to this kind of like robotic kind of thing. There were certainly like writers like, you know, C. Wright Mills and Marcuse and others who were saying like, oh, you know, this like cybernetic society is going to like fuck us up. And like that, all those ideas trickle into the counterculture, right? I feel like, I mean, I have a bunch of like old hippie posters on my wall that I'm staring at right now. They're like, you know, we need to get back to loving trees and like staring each other's eyes and like, you know, return to the human. But like, there's an irony to that too, because like the counterculture I think of as like really like kind of coming together with tech in exactly where you are in the Bay Area and like making Silicon Valley and like fucking Steve Jobs and Apple and all that. They're a bunch of like stoned hippies who kind of like use the kind of visionary qualities of the counterculture to take that tech thing in a different direction. And that narrative is like, I wonder what you think of that narrative as a history of science person, because that's a very like pop narrative for me. I mean, that's just kind of my surface understanding of it. But does any of that any of that resonate with you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that totally tracks. I mean, I think there were, you know, during the late 60s and early 70s, there were always kind of two counterculture and new left approaches to technology. Some of the counterculture stuff you obviously see in, you know, the rise of Apple and a lot of the Bay Area kind of tech ventures, the first generation of that. But you also had, you know, people tearing up computer punch cards, people attempting to bomb computer centers. There was always a fair amount of resistance to that that kind of got buried in tech's narrative of the events.
That's crazy. And bombing or attempted terrorist bombings of computers?
Yeah. So like, you know, this is back in the days where these mainframe computers like took up entire rooms. So, you know, there were attempts to bomb, I think, the Iliac computer at Urbana-Champaign. Like, it was anti computer sentiment was pretty strong in the new left, I think.
Yeah.
And in society at large. I mean, like, this is a history that's, you know, just now starting to be recovered, but from the very beginning of, you know, the first wave of automation in the late 50s and early 60s, there was always labor resistance to automation, and there was always, you know, deep skepticism towards what we usually call technological progress was going to do to working people, to the social fabric. But we for some reason we tend to rediscover the same tech critiques every generation.
That's the nostalgia trap, you know. literally just kind of like stuck in this cycle of like rediscovering the shit that the previous generation already discovered, integrated, forgot, and now we watch another generation be like, oh shit, computers.
Yeah. Yep.
that's so depressing. But like, I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about that first wave of automation, because I think a lot of people think automation is like something that's coming in the future or like is something that's happening just now. But you're mentioning that this is like the 50s and 60s. And I do associate the like immediate post World War II era with like a burst. I mean, every post-war period, really, with like a burst of like new technological innovation and that becoming like more integrated into the consumer world and things like that. But what is exactly is happening with automation in the 50s and 60s?
So I guess I can take kind of a personal angle with this, if that's okay.
Yeah, that's what we do here, man.
So my dad's a machinist. And this is like one of the trades that has been kind of on the front line of automation for a really long time. In the 1950s and 1960s, there was massive research mostly at MIT into basically allowing computers to, you know, automatically run machine tools. Computer numerical control is what it's called. So like over the course of the 60s and 70s, computer numerical control completely reorganized my dad's kind of, you know, occupation.
Sure.
Instead of, you know, having a machinist have to mill or lathe like every part of every every part of every part, you could store instructions and run them again and again and again. And what ended up happening, my dad trained in such a way that he was more or less safe from this, but what ended up happening was that my dad ended up becoming a programmer. I mean, machinists are never really considered, you know, tech workers or programmers for, I guess, pretty classed reasons. But my dad has been, you know, programming since the 70s. So you have a complete, you know, retransformation of like not only the way labor is organized in the field, but like the ways that, you know, the knowledge of individual workers can be used and reused by you know, corporations and
I mean at one point, like, the human issue, you know, and I know this, like, kind of intersects with the kind of labor issue and all that, but the idea that your dad sounds lucky, in other words, that he was able to, like, transition to doing the programming part of it, because I imagine that a lot of machinists were not so lucky, and like, they're just like out of a job and going to a different industry or something.
Yeah, I mean, like, so my dad ended up having to, I'm from Georgia, but my dad is from Western New York, from outside of Rochester, and ended up, you know, having to get up and move to the South because, you know, these jobs were in rapid decline and all along the Rust Belt. So, you know, he was lucky, but if he didn't move, it could have been a completely different story too.
Oh man, this is like my survey of the 20th century class, because it's like it's like, you know, the typical story is of people moving to the Sun Belt for tech jobs in the 70s. Is that about the time that your dad is heading to Georgia?
Yeah. So he heads to Georgia in the late 70s. Yeah.
Yeah.
So after working for a while for, you know, he worked for Kodak for a while in Rochester and some smaller kind of machine shops. But eventually it didn't work.
Were you born in Georgia?
Yeah, I'm born in Georgia. My mom is from Georgia too. Mm-hmm. So,
are you an identified Southerner?
I was not an identified Southerner growing up, but once I left the South, it was a label very quickly put on to me. So, you know, you just ended up accepting it and, you know, feeling a certain amount of pride. And
it's funny how that works. I felt the same thing. Yeah. I never really had any pride in Southern California. I thought I, like, didn't fit in here. This is lame. You know, this is like all like surfers and people that I don't really identify with. But then when I get to New York City, everyone just tells me, wow, you're so Californian. And I'm like, what the fuck does that mean? What do you mean? But also, yeah, defensive and be like, yeah, I am Californian and that's okay.
Yeah, it's kind of a similar trajectory towards like my own. Like, I was always a pretty class conscious person and a pretty, you know, growing up, I was, I guess, uncommonly for the South, raised like with strong support for unions. We, you know, there weren't many pickets in the South, but, you know, when they were, we were taught like never to cross a picket. I think I was taught never to cross a picket line before I even knew how to tie my shoes. But
where does that come from? I mean, obviously your parents, but I mean, I feel like that's a big dividing line on this show. Even talking about when we talk to like lefties and things like that, it's like people are either like, oh, I was raised by like reactionaries that like, and it turned me into a lefty because I was so disgusted by that. Or it's like, I was raised by people who were telling me about picket lines before I could speak. Are your parents apparently union people?
Yeah, well, so my dad was a union person when he still lived in New York. Union manufacturing jobs are pretty hard to come by in the South, and you know, that's most of the appeal of moving all of these jobs to the Sun Belt in the first place. My mom is they're both retired now, but my mom was a government worker and you know, a lifelong union member.
Cool.
So kind of uncommon for the South. It was moving outside of kind of a Southern and a working class universe to, you know, an elite private institution. I did my PhD at Northwestern. That kind of clarified things a lot for me.
Oh man, I want to hear that trajectory, because before we get there, I mean, what about undergrad? Where did you go for that, and what did you study, and why, I guess?
So I went to Georgia State, which is It's in downtown Atlanta. It's the third university in Georgia after UGA and Tech. But it's a working class institution, and it's a institution like, so it's majority non-white. It had like a lot of people were like me, first generation college students. So I felt like I kind of had the best possible introduction into the world of academia. But, you know, as soon as I stepped outside of that world, I quickly started to realize how fucked up things were.
Yeah, that makes sense. So, yeah. So a first generation college student, I'm the same way, from like kind of working parents. That can be like, I don't know, that can almost like create a division between you and your parents, too. It's a weird thing.
Yeah. I do kind of feel like I'm between two worlds, mm-hmm. you know, which is good in a lot of ways, I guess, but it makes life a lot more difficult to navigate. It's a lot harder to talk about work with my parents and like where I'm going to get a job when I'm done and things like that.
Yeah, I'm sure. I mean, for me, like even like learning about like, I don't know, the various like humanities stuff in college separated me from my parents and made me feel like, oh, they don't know anything. And there was definitely a period of feeling like, oh, we're in different worlds. But as time has gone on and I've, you know, become back to like contingent academic and all that, those divisions don't seem as profound.
Yeah, I think it was for me what really made things, what really made me able to, you know, be able to make academia legible to my parents was like just getting involved in unionization efforts. you know, yeah. nothing unites the working class like hatred.
Yeah,
towards the boss.
that's true. Yeah, and that's a great bridge.
Yeah. So at Northwestern, I guess reasons I've already gotten into, I've always been kind of interested in technology and its relationship to politics and political economy and things like that. So I did that at Northwestern.
What made you want to get a PhD? I mean, what was your vision? Because I mean, especially as a first gen person, you know, I didn't really even know what a PhD program was. I was just kind of like working shitty jobs in the valley and thinking I could go somewhere and do something else. And I've always wanted to go back to school, and a PhD program seems like a big, long set of time and effort that I could like devote myself to. But in other words, I didn't really understand the whole kind of like world that I was entering into. But why did you, do you remember like why exactly you wanted to get a PhD?
Oh yeah. It seemed like, you know, like I guess kind of perversely, it seemed like the best option.
Yeah.
You know, it was 5 to, you know, 7 years where I will be getting paid, where I will have health insurance. You know, I made sure to pick a program where our pay wasn't great, our health insurance wasn't great, but, you know, it was better than the jobs I was working. It was, you know, better than most of the job. Like, it was a better option than most of the other ones. So, I think a lot of people who are, there are two kind of different kinds of left politics right now. There's kind of like a working class left politics, and then there's like a downwardly mobile professional class politics on the left.
Yeah.
So I see a lot of people saw grad school as, you know, like a pay cut, a sacrifice, but it seemed, you know, even if there wasn't a job at the end of it, it seemed like just as good of an option as anything else for me.
That's really interesting. I never really thought about that. But entering a PhD program would kind of be a sacrifice or step down for some, depending on their like kind of class position. Whereas for, it sounds like people like us, we were kind of seeing it as a step up and into like something that could lead to a more kind of quote unquote, I don't know, professional existence. But really, like for me, maybe it's even like less precarious is the word rather than professional.
Yeah, that was definitely. And you know, I graduated from college in 2007. Mm-hmm. So right.
Oh God.
Right,
yeah.
Right during the financial crisis, and you know, youth unemployment was stratospheric. There really weren't better options. So I think a lot of us just decided, what the hell, I'll see if I can swing this academia thing.
Yeah. I was already embedded in graduate school in 2007. This is like the transition from George W. to Obama. And like, I think it's funny because I remember that time watching the housing crisis and being like, thank God I'm still in grad school for like several more years. Time to like slow down the dissertation writing and see if I can like crank out a few more years of this. It's funny because there was a dude in my neighborhood that was like, my parents called him like a lifelong PhD or lifelong grad student. And people always like kind of talked about him as if he was like kind of lazy or getting away with something. But I was always like, that guy's got something figured out.
Yeah, no, like the kind of ponytailed Simpsons
yes.
version of the grad student kind of seems like a folk hero to me.
He's totally. Yeah. Yeah, I agree. So at Northwestern, I wonder what that was like in terms of like going from Georgia, you know, you went to a public university in Georgia where things are kind of like there's a little bit of class homogeneity. What happens at Northwestern? Because that's in Chicago, right? I feel like a big private university in Chicago is going to be a different experience.
It's not only like the geographic and cultural difference, but like the amount of money that was swirling around that university was just preposterous. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's got an $11 billion endowment. So, you know, it can afford to pay grad students essentially whatever it wants. Mm. But like when I was there, before we started like kind of ramping up our union effort after it, you know, there was a Columbia decision in 2016 that basically made it legal for grad workers at private universities to unionize and to mm-hmm. seek union recognition. When that happened, I think there was a lot of anger that we were able to tap in because, you know, we had this extraordinarily rich university that was trying to sell a austerity line to us and laying off staff, trying to cut our benefits, basically saying there's no money when we can see their financials, you know?
Right.
And a lot of us who started our unionization effort at Northwestern had been involved in one way or another with the Chicago Teachers Union strike in 2012.
I forgot how big a deal that was. That was a big deal, and something that I like again. Like you kind of like, I remember the Chicago the Window Workers Union Chicago was like popping off for a bit, and like Obama was almost like kind of trying to like. Kind of maintain solidarity or appear well at the same time, like he came from Chicago and was kind of embedded in all the like kind of uglier end of that. I remember that now. That was a very particular politics of that era.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think a lot of us had unions on the mind, and we'd had a little bit of whether it was, you know, like solidarity activities or, you know, plenty of us, you know, Northwestern's up in Evanston, which is like a northern suburb, but most of us live in Chicago because it's much, much cheaper. Mm. So a lot of us had spouses or significant others who worked for Chicago Public Schools. So we had some experience with unions going into this. So I think all of this was on our minds.
At Northwestern, what do you encounter academically? How did you kind of come to your dissertation topic? I mean, and maybe you can tell us what your dissertation is about.
Oh yeah. I'm always terrible at that. So my dissertation, which I'm doing the thing where you turn it into a book now, is about, the Limits to Growth Report, which was a kind of landmark environmental text that came out in 1972 that used, a computer model to basically say if trends in economic growth, pollution, and population growth continued, there would be an environmental collapse somewhere around 2050. So it was one of these kind of landmark pre-climate change environmental texts.
That's fucking insane, dude. Like 2050 seems like where, like, I don't know, like the climate science movement, you know, all of that even like Emma Gonzalez and all of the kind of climate change people, the different teenage girls that have become our spokespeople around the world about this issue. That's kind of what they're saying, right? I mean, it's almost like I want to know more about like what this computer model is and who put it together.
So it's kind of a wild story. So it was put together by two groups. The group that commissioned it was a group that's kind of now shrouded in a bunch of conspiracy theories, not entirely without cause, called the Club of Rome.
If you tell me that Jeffrey Epstein created this report, I'm going to have a problem, man.
No, but there is like a third order Jeffrey Epstein connection. I probably shouldn't get into.
All right, let's start with the basics then.
So the Club of Rome was this group of mostly kind of mid-level international bureaucrats and businessmen and, you know, various kinds of elites, like not the top elites, but kind of mid-level elites that in the 1960s became very worried about essentially technology run amok, like what technology was doing to the social fabric, to, you know, the environment, basically how it was destabilizing society. Mm. So it's in some ways like I wouldn't call it a completely conservative, but like a kind of conservative concern about technology that, you know, it's kind of shredding social bonds. And they founded it, they organized around 1968. And over the next 4 years, they became more and more concerned with environmental issues because it was where technology and industrialization and economic growth were, like, I guess, showing up much, like, very acutely. Mm-hmm. So they commissioned this report by this strange figure, Jay Forrester, and his graduate students, essentially, to kind of model, like, if present trends continue in economic life, and, you know, because it was the early 70s and population growth, like what would happen? And they basically said there's almost no way out other than rapidly slowing economic growth and population growth. Jay Forrester is like a crazy figure that deserves his own story. I can get into that if you want.
Yeah, but for sure. Because, you know, the reason I kind of was made aware of Jay Forrester is through an article that that you wrote last year called Model Metropolis, which people can check out. I think is it Logic Zine? Is that the name of or Logic Mag? And I can put the link up with the episode. But you wrote a piece that kind of connected Forrester's work to SimCity, which is, you know, kind of a popular expression of, it sounds like, it almost like, you know, a video game of like modeling cities and predictive models and kind of like the idea that you could kind of put in some data and then watch it play out over time. And so the Sims became kind of a cultural institution, you know, over the, I mean, are they still, I feel like they're still making the Sims, right?
Yeah.
So I'd love to hear more about Forrester. Where's that guy come from?
So he comes from, he's another MIT creature. He was one of these people who was a grad student during the Second World War and was involved in, you know, in the war effort. So he worked on stabilizing radar, basically stabilizing radars on aircraft carriers, mm-hmm. which is kind of a complex, like, control task, because you can't necessarily predict waves, and, like, you know, radar dishes have to be pointed to the horizon. So it's like it's a complex automatic control problem. And, after the war, he becomes like a computing pioneer. He creates, or like, he's in charge of Project Whirlwind, which is one of the most important early computer systems. You know, it develops magnetic core memory, which is like the ancestor to today's RAM. It was standard on mainframes for 30 years. This becomes the Whirlwind project becomes the centerpiece to SAGE, the semi-automatic ground environment, which is like this continent spanning early warning detection system for like incoming Soviet bombers. So what it would do would be like feeding in information from radar sites all over North America, US and Canada, into this elaborate computing system, which would detect unexpected incoming aircraft and automatically deploy fighters to intercept these bombers. Of course, like this cost billions of dollars and it was obsolete essentially the second it came out because of, you know, intercontinental ballistic missiles. But it was one of these really important early links between the computing industry and the military industrial complex.
Yeah. Yeah.
After that's done, he decides that he doesn't want to work on, you know, designing computer systems anymore and moves to a management school, the Sloan School of Management, where he tries to like take some of the things that he learned about human machine systems and apply them to you know, social systems. So his early work is in, you know, modeling supply chain problems for corporations. He does a lot of work consulting for companies, like you know, a lot of the early computing startups, but also like Hi-C and Minute Maid and like all sorts of weird stuff. Jesus. So he's like coming up in this like first major generation of management consultants, sort of like your Pete Buttigieg 1.0 generation.
Jesus.
Like back when McKinsey's making a name.
It sounds so insidious and evil to me, and maybe I'm putting the wrong charge on it, but like, you know, it reminds me of the late 19th century and like William Frederick Taylor and Taylorism and like the coming of the idea of industrial efficiency and scientific efficiency and industrial production and like sitting there with a fucking stopwatch and figuring out like how these lines work and everything. It just seems like another iteration of that, but even more like profound in how deep it's like linked into the whole operation of the economy.
Right. So I tend to think of this stuff as, you know, like Taylorism is kind of focused on like the, you know, the micro emotions of individual workers. And this, like the kind of stuff Forrester was doing was kind of like Taylorism for organizations, sort of, you know, like streamlining the flows of materials, of knowledge, and, you know, like kind of reorganizing firms for the information age, essentially. So this is like what he ended up doing over the course of the early 60s. Mm-hmm. And he kind of, you know, wants to scale up his methodology towards the end of the 1960s. He's not content for it to just be like the field then is called industrial dynamics. He's not content for it just to be like a methodology for modeling corporations. He wants some like kind of social, he wants it to be able to do other kinds of social systems too. So he pairs up with the outgoing mayor of Boston, John Collins, he's kind of like one of these weird, you know, he's like kind of a Daniel Patrick Moynihan Democrat. Like he's kind of a conservative anti-welfare Democrat who, you know, cozies up to the Nixon administration.
Yuck. I hate these guys. These are the worst.
Yeah, they're the worst. I mean, like they, you know, in a lot of ways, they kind of won. But
yeah, totally.
In the long run. But he pairs up with this guy and his staff, like his advisors, to create a model of what is supposed to be the American city in the urban crisis of the late 1960s. So, you know, this is a time of, you know, massive upheaval, like riots, or like from, you know, like all sorts of urban unrest, you know, the Watts riot, like, you know, like there's cities are basically on fire and, you know, for good reason. Mm-hmm. You know, poverty is stratospheric, or, you know, everything's terrible.
To put the, and deindustrialization is happening too. And like, it's part, right. And you know, like, yeah, white flight. I mean, there's so many stories to tell there, but yeah, this, it's interesting that they're like kind of seeing that and seeing, that some sort of tech answer in that, it sounds like.
Yeah. So there had been efforts to model cities before, but they tend to be like in the early 60s, they tended to be around like traffic problems and you know, smaller scale things, but like urban dynamics, the model that Forrester and Collins's team ended up coming up with was supposed to be kind of a model of urban decline, of the urban crisis, and basically used Boston as a stand-in for, you know, all of American cities. This model was created basically entirely by talking to Collins and his staff. He didn't talk to, you know, like any people actually experiencing like urban poverty or slum conditions. He didn't even really talk to any like urban sociologists or other kinds of experts. He thinks that the major stores of knowledge aren't necessarily like these academic fields, but like what he regards as like the real people working on these issues. So like top level bureaucrats, I guess. And the model they come up with is, it's actually kind of insane.
Like I'm imagining it is.
it basically argues that every kind of program of the great society is going to actually make problems worse. Like they argued that like things like jobs training programs were bad because somehow they would lure poor people into the city and like make the city even poorer. Somehow there was like a lot of like really creepy dependence, like welfare dependency arguments in it. There was a lot of like just like bizarre classist assumptions embedded in it, into it. And for like a moment where racial issues and urban issues are kind of impossible to extricate from one another, their model was like entirely colorblind in the worst sense of the word. Like there was no racial element to it at all. So you couldn't understand issues like redlining or housing segregation. It was basically a conservative Democrats takedown of the great society. And you know, people like, yeah, and people like Moynihan loved it.
Yeah, like, I bet they did. I mean, it sounds like the logic of it is like, oh, you know, we have a machine now that can like objectify all this stuff and just show. In other words, like they're pretending like that it's like free of any politics or anything, but it also sounds like they're using the machine to just like get what they want of their agenda.
Yeah, I mean, like the kind of things that people in industrial dynamics and now what's called system dynamics always say is like, our models show you the unexpected results of like policies that are, you know, carried out without an eye towards like second order effects, like, you know, beyond like the impact of like just, you know, like giving people jobs or housing or money, like what actually goes on during the line. But like almost always these guns are aimed at working people, poor people, people of color. It's a story that sounds very familiar today, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost like the machine is like a machine for creating a self-fulfilling prophecy in some way.
Yeah, I mean, the way I kind of think of it is like these models, especially the Forrester style models, are basically thought experiments put into code. There's very little validation of these models, meaning like there aren't many, like, whatever you want to say about like experts, there's very little expert validation of these models. So like people in urban studies fields in the late 60s when this came out, and in 69 when it came out, were kind of looked at this thing and said like, what the fuck is even going on with this?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
None of this checks out at all. But it, you know, it was able to serve a kind of useful purpose for the right, because in the 1960s, technical expertise was kind of it had a broadly liberal interventionist tack.
Right.
So you had like the McNamara stuff, but you also had like people trying to bring systems expertise to bear to like sell and refine great society programs. And the right like had no idea what to do with this, because like they had no, you know, they didn't have their own models essentially. So what they saw in this was a great way to kind of use the weapons of the Johnson administration against the great society. And they were pretty successful. Like
Yeah, I mean, I associate tech and like the idea of relying on tech. I mean, we're talking about Iowa, right? With like a kind of liberal kind of sensibility that like, I mean, especially like, I mean, I'm a kind of 90s kid in some way. And like, especially accelerating into the 2000s with the coming of, you know, Google and Twitter and social media, there was always that kind of like techno utopic element that seemed like we're all the liberals and we're going to create a more progressive society by kind of further embedding tech into everything we do.
Yeah. And I think what they didn't necessarily foresee in all of this, like even the well-intentioned people, is that, you know, this is a profoundly depoliticizing project, kind of reducing every single issue to a matter of technical expertise. And, you know, you basically cut movements out of the process. You cut people out of the process. You basically say like, this is our domain. Get the fuck out. Like,
yeah, I mean, doesn't it also accelerate the model from 1972 that says we're all going to be dead by 2050? Like, in other words, like all the things that all the trends that they're identifying with early on, particularly like, for me, I think a lot about the fact that tech is like, it requires labor, requires extraction of minerals in Africa and other, you know, already colonized areas, and like increases all the kind of environmental catastrophe. It seems like the more tech, the more there's a weird irony to that almost, right?
Yeah. I mean, just consider the massive amounts of energy that, you know, like Amazon servers soak up. I mean, like the cloud is, you know, imagined as this kind of disembodied, non-material kind of thing in the ether. But cloud services have a huge environmental footprint and have a huge material footprint. Like, these rare earth metals don't come from nowhere. They come from impoverished areas in Africa that just end up fueling conflicts, kind of like blood diamonds in the 90s.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and child labor and all sorts of ugly military excursions. And yeah, it seems that kind of notion of accelerationism versus deceleration seems like it's part of our politics today too, still.
Yeah. And I think a lot of this is like, both the economy and technology have both become kind of fetishes that obscure everything else. So like, you know, it's hack to say it at this point, but like, GDP doesn't tell you anything about like working conditions, about standard of living. It's just like a kind of top line result that, you know, obscures more than it illuminates.
Right.
And the same thing goes for tech. I mean, like, one of the major challenges as somebody who studies, you know, science and technology is just kind of getting beyond, you know, like seeing beyond tech. I mean, like, these aren't just like devices or processes. Like, these are like, these things serve to obscure, you know, politics, labor. So like, you know, like when we talk about the politics of Uber, we're not even like talking about technology. We're talking about like regulatory arbitrage, really.
Yeah.
So one of my major tasks, I think, is kind of removing the veneer of tech to see the social relations underneath.
That's such a great way of putting it. What an important project. I mean, I'm wondering, like, in that 1972 prophecy, I mean, I call it a prophecy, whatever. I mean, it's funny because it comes from an era where a lot of people were thinking about this stuff. Like, there was a big oil spill in Santa Barbara, I think, in 1969. And there was, like, you know, a lot more kind of awareness of, like, industrial impact on the environment and human beings and animals and things like that. So, in other words, the 72 model almost seems like it falls into that, but it also, like, how did people take that? I mean, is it something that's kind of lost to history, that model? Because there is a kind of eeriness to it, to me, in the sense of, like, the model almost seems right.
Yeah, it's one of those things that is not necessarily like lost to history, but has kind of been narratively interpreted in different ways by different people.
Yeah.
So the right, and like especially the anti-environmentalist right, like, has been using the Limits to Growth Report, that has been like calling it discredited for, you know, now around 50 years, and using it as basically a hammer, like kind of like with the little ice age scares of the mid 70s and late 70s.
Holy shit. To, yeah. Yep.
To kind of hammer away at, you know, contemporary climate politics. Mm. And the environmental movement has been kind of using it as a way to kind of like tell the early part of its story, the prehistory, like before we had these big global circulation models that, you know, could model the entire climate with a fairly sophisticated degree of resolution. So, but I think the real warning that I take away from the Limits of Growth report is that, like, this is not the kind of work that we need to be doing. Like, the science, you know, is relatively, like, it's out. Like, it's settled now, it's defined. We need to be doing the organizing work and the political work, instead of yelling at people to listen to the scientists, we need to be, you know, organizing for a Green New Deal and mm-hmm. you know, transitional justice and things
I'd love to a little more about that, because I wonder, it's something I wonder about all the time, and I don't know the answer to, but, you know, for a while there was this kind of accelerationist attitude. I think that Elon Musk actually kind of like falls into that idea, or maybe a lot of his fans do, that like, oh, like, climate change isn't going to be a problem because we're going to like tech it out. We're going to find a way to like create a giant vacuum cleaner that's going to suck all the pollution out of the air. And like, you know, we're going to create cars that run on, you know, garbage, and just like in Back to the Future 2, and like all this crazy shit. And I'm like, wait a second, why would tech do that? Like, the imperatives of the imperatives of capital and war are what drive tech. And like that just seems like a bad way to go. Or even like an impossible mm-hmm. way to go. But then I'm like, okay, if I'm a left person, like, should I be a decelerationist? Because then it's like, we have like almost, what, 7.5 billion people on the planet, something like that. Like, being supported by these structures that we created, how do we fucking decelerate from that without like lots of people like dying? It's just, in other words, it just seems like we've backed ourselves into a civilizational corner, and I'm not mm-hmm. sure like what the proper left response is.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult. I mean, the crazy thing about like the kind of right accelerationist story, like the Elon Musk story,
yeah,
is that it actually has roots squarely in the Limits of Growth report. So Patrick McRae, another historian of science and technology, wrote a book about this called The Visioneers, where he basically says like this panic in the early 1970s about resource scarcity, you know, largely around the Limits of Growth, but also around things like the energy crisis, launched the first wave of this kind of tech utopian thinking, like right. people thinking about space colonization and asteroid mining and nanotechnology and all of this stuff. This was all motivated by this first generation of fears about you know, dwindling natural resources.
So like make it like the Jetsons, so we don't end up like the Flintstones.
Right. Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. And like this is kind of a way of like being able to like endlessly defer like the end of, I guess, capitalist accumulation forever.
Right.
Like we can keep this machine going forever. It's never gonna run out of gas.
And we're never gonna have to pay the bill.
Right. 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 Yeah. Yeah.
It's kind of almost like we're modeling our whole civilization on, like, I don't know, credit card debt or something.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. It's exactly like that. The left response has been, you know, as you know, left responses often are, like, kind of fractured and factionalized.
Totally. Yeah. I have people on my Twitter who are like, you know, hardcore decelerationists and vice versa. And it's like, they hate other people on the left that are like tech people. And it's like, it's really there. In other words, there's not a monolith, a monolithic opinion on this. And I'm definitely someone who tries to balance it all out and figure out what it all means. Cause you know, these are really big issues. And it sounds like the, you know, the SimCity model has been to like plug all the data in and see how it plays out that way. But that also seems like a problem to me too.
Yeah, I mean, the way I tend to think of these problems is that, you know, tech may be the way out, Maybe, but but the way that you know, research and development in the tech sector is organized right now is basically to, like, since the 1960s, since the beginning of the 1960s, has been to boost GDP. It hasn't been, you know, to improve, like, social welfare. It hasn't even, you know, been to, like, make markets more competitive. So any kind of tech solution that's going to come for the climate crisis or come for, like, that will solve, like, any of our crises is going to have to involve massive reorganization and reprioritization of the way funding works in universities and in corporations, you know, like NSF allocates funding. I mean, especially since the 80s, like, the major focus of universities, you know, STEM departments has been creating, like, patentable products. Like, it's yeah. it's a market university now.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's like kind of taking capitalism out of the university or even, like, a bigger thing. It seems like, I don't know, using the institutional kind of structures that we have, but kind of changing, like, forcefully changing the way power flows through them. I know that's kind of like a vague way of putting it, but it seems like that's a big part of the project. In other words, not tearing it down, but using it and kind of repurposing it.
Yeah, it's kind of like the same thing with, like, a factory nationalization. Like,
yeah.
This exists, this institution exists, but what are we doing with it? What goals does it serve? I mean, it's just a scaled up version of, like, some very old left problems in a lot of ways.
Oh, God. yeah, we could go on and on, but we should wrap it up. I wanted to ask you real quick, though, what brought you to Berkeley and how do you like the Bay Area? Because it seems like the Bay Area is a place where it's like ground zero for all this tech shit.
Yeah, it's very strange because you have both, you know, it's ground zero, but in a lot of ways, it's also like ground zero to the resistance to it.
Yeah.
You have a lot of tech worker organizing, you know, people who are pretty, like, well compensated workers, but are quickly realizing that, like, their goals and their employer's goals don't align. You have, like, you know, like, the gig work economy, people are organizing against that. So it's like it's an interesting place to be because it's kind of like, it's kind of the tech economy at its highest, most depraved form. So you get to see, like, the new modes of resistance emerging there too. So it's, you know, it's an exciting place to be.
That's great. I wanted to read the last part of your piece that I think kind of can kind of put a nice little thesis on a lot of this stuff. You said, straightforward solutions to poverty and economic misery, redistribution and the provision of public services have both empirical backing and moral force. Maybe it's time we start listening to our intuition again. I thought that was such a beautiful way of putting it, Kevin. And I just wanted to thank you for sharing your ideas with us because I think they're really important.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. I love talking.
Cool. Take care.
Thanks.
All right, I want to give a big thank you to Kevin Baker. I had a great time talking with him, and I hope you enjoyed that conversation. Go follow him on Twitter at Kevin Baker. He posts a lot of really interesting and engaging stuff about technology and politics that I think a lot of lefties would really enjoy. So go check that out. And again, we're putting up a lot more stuff on our Patreon where we're talking about deeper kind of conversations about what's really going on in the world, current event type stuff. If you're interested in hearing our thoughts on that, go to patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. We've got some great episodes with Justin Rogers Cooper. I know he's a favorite of everybody that listens to the show. So if you want to hear those, go to patreon.com/nostalgiatrap and sign up. Thanks so much, and we'll talk to you very soon. Take care. Bye-bye.